So today we are talking about the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. Now you're going to think I'm reading the entire Bible today, and because we're going to let the Bible do all of the teaching. I'm going to read something to you that I put in this morning and did not put in when I was giving the scriptures to those who put them up on the screen. And I'm reading from 2 Peter chapter 3, and I'm reading from the New Living Bible. But I wanted to say this as we begin. It starts in verse 3. First, I want to remind you that in the last days there will be scoffers who will laugh at the truth and do every evil thing they desire. This will be their argument. Jesus promised to come back, did he? Then where is he? Why, as far back as anyone can remember, everything has remained exactly the same since the world was first created. That's what the scoffers say. They deliberately forget that God made the heavens by the word of his command, and he brought the earth up from the water and surrounded it with water. Then he used the water to destroy the world with a mighty flood. I think I'm going through verse 9. And God has also commanded that the heavens and the earth will be consumed by fire on the day of judgment, when ungodly people will perish. But you must not forget, dear friends, that a day is like 1,000 years to the Lord, and 1,000 years is like a day. The Lord isn't really being slow about his promise to return, as some people think. No, he's being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to perish, so he's given more time for people everywhere to repent. And then I'm going to verse 14 and 15a. And so, dear friends, while you are waiting for these things to happen, make every effort to live a pure and blameless life and be at peace with God. And remember, the Lord is waiting so that people have time to be saved. Now, people have tried to discount and to ignore the fact that the universe was created out of nothing by the Word of God. People tend to discount, or they try to ignore that what seemed to be a perfectly millennial ago, what seems to be like a perfectly normal day, God destroyed the world with a flood. We also have a tendency to forget, in the same way that people tend to discount or ignore the fact that life on earth will not continue to go along like it always has. For God has announced beforehand in his word that the end of our age will be marked by a series of awesome and spectacular events. We are living in the last days, and the Lord has said we are in the last of the last days. So here we are, a period which extends from the birth of Jesus Christ until the time when he returns to the earth, the rapture of the church. Christ is going to come in the air and take away every member of his true church. Underline true. Both living and dead, to be with him forever in their new, with their new glorified bodies, as we live with him in heaven. There will be a 7-year period. I'm just trying to summarize so you get a handle before we actually jump into some things. There will be a 7-year period when the church departs of unparalleled satanic activity, wickedness and war, destruction and disturbance, beyond ever before seen or heard of, except in the book of Revelation, where it is outlined by the Spirit of God Almighty what will take place. At the end of the tribulation period, Christ will return to the earth with his angels and disciples who were previously raptured. He will defeat the armies of the world and judge those men and women on earth who are still alive. He will totally defeat Satan. He's already defeated Satan, but he will put him down and all of his forces, rendering them totally inactive. And then he will resurrect those who have believed on him during the time of the tribulation period. Then a 1,000-year reign will begin, and where we will reign with him on the earth, and that will happen, of course, at the end of the tribulation period. Now, you have to understand that in Hosea 4:6, and that this is not on the screen, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. So ignorance does not cut it. We need to understand what God's word said. So we have an opportunity to share with other people. You have an opportunity to share the pre-trib that Jesus is coming, and to understand that know what you're experiencing, what's happening in the world. Know we are not in tribulation. We may be in the little T, but we are not in that big T of tribulation. The church does not, will not, shall not be a part of any of that, and the Bible teaches that. So there are at least 7 reasons to trust in the doctrine of the pre-tribulation rapture of the church, and we will talk about all of those today. And you know, because it is a foundational doctrine of the church. But the very first thing I want to say, that you put a smile on your face, is to tell you this: there's no problem in your life that won't be fixed by the rapture. Amen. So let's get that under control, okay?
Hallelujah.
No matter what it is. And the next thing on the scene is the rapture. Hallelujah. And oh my goodness. So let's look at these 7 reasons. Number 1, types and examples from the Old Testament. So Enoch and Elijah were both raptured, the scripture says. Enoch and Elijah. Again, I'm going to give you these scriptures. Enoch and Elijah were both raptured. But in Hebrews 9:27 it says, it is appointed for men to die once. These two guys did not die. Enoch and Elijah. They never died. They were raptured instead. Now, that to me, I'm not preaching on that today, but that to me says that they are the two witnesses who return in the book of Revelation. These two guys, to me, are the two witnesses, Enoch and Elijah, that will be coming back in the book of Revelation during the time with the Antichrist and that whole crowd, and the ones that will be killed and lay, and the whole world will see them lying there. We now can see as they lay in Jerusalem, and we will see them come, you know, be taken up to heaven and come back to life. Anyway, so Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15:51 and 52. Let's look there. 1 Corinthians 15:51 and 52. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. So we're going to be in, this is a mystery, he says. We're not all going to, you know, we will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment. Now, Noah and his family escaped in the ark. We're talking about examples now. I'm still under number 1, types and examples of the Old Testament. So Noah and his family escaped in the ark and were saved from the flood. That's an example. Number 2, Lot and his family escaped the destruction of Sodom. The Lord got them out of there. Both of them are examples of being rescued before the destruction by the hand of God. Amen. Remember, during tribulation is the wrath of God. You have to keep that in your mind. The tribulation is the wrath of God. And both of these, Noah and Lot, before the wrath of God came, both of them, righteous men, were taken out before the wrath of God came. Now, 2 Peter 2, 4 through 9, For if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into hell and committed them to pits of darkness reserved for judgment, and did not spare the ancient world, but preserved Noah, a preacher of righteousness, with seven others, when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly, only eight people, including Noah, escaped the flood. That man preached for over 100 years. Now you have to understand, they probably paid attention at first because they probably was taken back by this crazy man, what are you building? I mean, they hadn't seen rain, much less a boat. And so I'm sure they were, paid attention for, but when 100 years go by and nothing happened, what do they do? They're doing what people are doing today. You've been talking about this forever and forever. We haven't seen anything. I mean, you made sense to start off with, but I mean, we haven't seen anything really happen and nothing's ever. Exactly the scripture I read to you in 2 Peter 3. They've been talking about this forever. And out of that, the only people that were saved, and we're not talking about a few dozen people that were on the face of the earth. There were thousands of people that lived during that time. Go back and check it and read it. There were thousands of people that lived. And only eight people. Let's put it this way. One family. Noah and his family. And not even all of his family. With Lot, I mean Lot, not even all of Lot's family left with him. But this appears to be Noah and his complete family. They came, they left with him. Eight people preached it and preached it and preached it and told them what he was doing, why he was doing it. And it just became too much because it took too long. Are you listening? It did not fit their mentality. It did not go with their thinking. Come on, church. You have to be careful. God brought back to us a vision he gave me in 1996 pertaining to linens. And I would see emaciated people lying on a bed on the Word, covered over with the Word, and their head laying on the Word. And then they would spring up as they released their faith, totally healed. It covers your entire bed. And you're going to release your faith because they've already been anointed with oil and prayed over. But you learn to release your faith. And as you release your faith, God intervened. It's just a way to release your faith. It is the Word of God Almighty and a vision of 24 years ago. The twins are 165, the full are 209, the queens are 220, and the kings are 236. You give them as a gift. Do anything you can to spread the gospel and get the Word in somebody's face. Now, number two, the tribulation period is described in Daniel as a time of Jacob's trouble. God will deal with the Jews, it talks about, and with the nation of Israel during the tribulation. You say, well, the tribulation, it could be way off. No, it's not. Read your Bible. We're on the outskirts. Read your Bible. You can almost close your eyes and see tribulation and things that will happen. And we can see the beginnings of them, sort of like the beginnings of building a boat. Jeremiah 37. Jeremiah 37. Alas, for that great day, for that day is great. There's none like it. And it is the time of Jacob's distress, but he will be saved from it. Daniel 9:24. 70 weeks have been decreed for your people and your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sin, to make atonement for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place. Daniel 12:7. I heard the man dressed in linen who was above the waters of the river, as he raised his right hand and his left toward heaven, and swore by him who lives forever that it would be for a time, times, and half a time. And as soon as they finish shattering the power of the holy people, all these events will be completed. The tribulation period is about unbelieving Israel, not about the true church. Amen. Now you need to write that on the tablet of your heart. The tribulation period is about unbelieving Israel, not about the true church, because we have talked about in previous messages the difference between play church and the true church and things that would take place. We've gone in depth about that with you. So how do you know that? How do we know that? Reason number three tells you that. Number three, there is no, big no, there is no biblical reference to the church being on earth after the end of Revelation 3 until Revelation 19. Write it and go read it. If you back up to the front and read the whole thing, a blessing comes with it. That's what it says at the beginning of Revelation. But there's no biblical reference, none, to the church at all being on earth after the end of Revelation 3 until Revelation 19. Chapter 4, verse 1 of Revelation. After these things, I looked up, that we've talked about the seven churches, they were in those first chapters. After these things, I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I had heard, like the sound of a trumpet speaking with me, said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after these things." Now the rapture, listen carefully, the rapture is a church event. It is not a world event.
Amen.
Are you listening? It is the explanation, you might really want to listen closely. It is the explanation point on the work of the Holy Spirit in the church. The Holy Spirit, through the church, is salt on the earth and as light in the world. When the rapture happens, there is a shift in the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Are you listening? From that point forward, the Holy Spirit's ministry is to those who are living in the tribulation. For salvation, because people will be saved. You cannot be saved without the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So from the point that the rapture happens, the ministry of the Holy Spirit changes. I'm repeating myself. I just want you to get it. Changes. The Holy Spirit's ministry then is to those who will live during tribulation, because many will come to the Lord during tribulation. And so the Holy Spirit will be leading many to the Lord, those who will come. The Holy Spirit does not force anybody, not anybody, to come. Today, he doesn't force anyone, not any of you, not any of you, not anyone does he force to come to the Lord God Almighty. And the Bible says, for those of you who says, "I will just come to the Lord when I feel like it, when I want to, got some things I want to do first." Whoa, you better hang on. The Bible says you cannot come without the wooing of the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
If you're sitting in this service today, if you're watching whatever might be going on, and you've got any kind of want to know God, any kind of anything that makes you, "I might want to know God," you better move on it.
Yes.
That's the Holy Spirit wooing you, pulling on you,
yes,
tugging on you. It's time to make a move.
Yes.
And if you're going to sit there and say, well, I'm not quite ready, got some more things I need to do, and when I get it all done, you can't tell the Holy Spirit when to move on you. So the Holy Spirit is going to be moving on tribulation people to come, and he's also there to grace those who will endure martyrdom. In tribulation, the tribulation saints, my friends, all those who are born again outside of a very small group will be martyred. That's what Revelation says. You do not want to be here during tribulation. I'm here to tell you. Some people get all shook up because they say the word rapture isn't in the Bible. Well, neither is the word Trinity and neither this word Bible. Hello, church. This is really deep. That is, the rapture, though, is in the Greek Bible, the Latin Bible, and the Russian Bible. It's a very simple word that simply means caught up or extracted by force suddenly. Woo! And away we go. Shoo! Number four. The church is promised an escape from divine wrath. The true church. Yes. It's very important that you put the word true in there. The true church is promised an escape from the wrath to come. And there are two kinds of wrath that will come. First, let's go to Matthew 7. We're talking about the true church. Let's go to Matthew 7, 15 through 23. Beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor figs from thistles, are they? So a good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good fruit cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So then you will know them by their fruits. So what are we called to do? Be fruit inspectors. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. This scripture used to horrify me until I got to know the Lord and understood it. If it hadn't ever bothered you, I don't know where you've been. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Lord Jesus. 1 Thessalonians 1:10. And to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, that is Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath to come. That's right, that word, rescue. Mm-hmm. Tell your neighbors, I want to be rescued. Jesus will rescue us, glory to God, from the wrath to come. 1 Thessalonians 5:9. For God has not destined us for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 5:9. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. Ooh, it's getting better. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This one, pretty good. Revelation 3:10. Because you have kept the word of my perseverance, I also will keep you from the hour of testing, that hour which is about to come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Now, I'm going to keep you, he says. Praise God. Now, the scripture speaks of the wrath of God, but it also speaks of the wrath of the Lamb. Are y'all learning anything?
Yes.
So it talks about the wrath of God, and it talks about the wrath of the Lamb. Look at Revelation 6, 16 through 17. And they said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the presence of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who is able to stand? They fall on us and hide us from the presence of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of their wrath has come. So we're talking about the wrath of God and the wrath of the Lamb. Revelation 14, 10. He also will drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is mixed in full strength in the cup of his anger. We're talking about the Antichrist here. And he will be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. Now let me remind you, when you get past Revelation 3, when you get past that, we're then beginning to talk about where the wrath of God begins to take place. Revelation 4 is beautiful. Revelation 5, we understand. But when you get on over there and it starts talking about all of the bowls and the trumpets and the different things, my friend, that's the wrath of God and the wrath of the Lamb. You and I will not be here if we are the bride of Christ and the true church of God. I'm keeping on saying that because I want people to understand it. So we're talking about this verse that we just read. It describes the wrath of the Lamb being felt through fire and brimstone. That again, for the Antichrist. Keep in mind, this happens after centuries of the Lord's patience, kindness, mercy, forgiveness, and still there are those who refuse his goodness. I'm here to tell you that not one single thing about the tribulation, what happens in Revelation after you get past chapter 3, all of that has to do with tribulation time. Those things have not already happened.